When did you get anorexia nervosa?
2 years ago at Christmas, I first started to have the symptoms. I became, I thought what was happening was that I had an ulcer. It was becoming very painful for me to eat. I couldn't enjoy food anymore, and I began to have an extreme sense of time and sensory distortion. There was no longer breakfast, lunch, and dinner. There was only a vague sea of food waiting to be consumed, but at what time and by whom, I didn't quite understand. I began to have a lot of personality problems, crying constantly, extreme depression, and just a constant sense of confusion. I began to ask everyone more and more insistently, when do you eat? What is eating for? What times of the day? How much did you eat today? Why does it hurt me so much? Crying. I could never get full. I was never hungry anymore, and I could never get full. And I began to become, and eating was very painful. I had to have a great deal of distress in my stomach, and I began to lose weight over the period of January, February. More and more weight was lost. It was going down and down, and experiencing more and more depression, confusion, and nearly nervous breakdown. I went to work and ended up crying one day. I couldn't go on. Any food hurt more and more. I began to have an instinct that the only way to heal myself was to fast, because I felt that if I just waited long enough, that magical sense of hunger and appetite that would tell me that I was a viable, functioning organism would come back to me, and it never returned. It went away, and I lost more and more weight, and every time I would go to the doctor and see that I had lost more weight, I was upset and confused. I would cry, I would burst into tears. Every week it was 5 more pounds, and I went to a clinic and looked, trying to find if I had an eating disorder, because I couldn't understand what was wrong. I thought I had an ulcer. They checked me out. That wasn't what was wrong. They could tell that I was upset and becoming hysterical, but they didn't know how to help me. And I read the symptoms for anorexia nervosa, which included loss of the menstrual period, and by then I had definitely lost my menstrual period. And I told the nurses, I believe this is what was wrong with me, but they said, no, that only happens to people that have been overweight. And not ever having been overweight or never having wanted to or intended to lose weight, I couldn't believe that that was what was wrong with me either. So I was left more and more in a state of, it's like being lost in a black hole in space. I had no idea what was wrong with me. I had no idea where my life was going. I knew that I was in a lot of pain, that I was very ill, and I was losing a lot of weight.
Why do you think you got anorexia?
It must be related to anxiety and stress and the endocrine malfunction that occurs as a result. The way that I experienced it was that a kinesthetic sense that had been true to me was no longer working. It was no longer functioning. I couldn't tell when it was time to eat. I was never hungry. I was never full. Full food didn't satisfy me, and I had no need for it, and therefore I was left with a constant feeling of being unfulfilled on a physiological or on an emotional level. I think that having reached a certain point in my life where I realized that I was alone, I was responsible for my life, for what I was going to make of it, that I was no longer in college, I hadn't got a career, I didn't have a family. As a woman, I was not very well focused. I felt that I didn't have a child, I didn't have a successful career, I wasn't successful as an artist, or any of the things that I had tried, and I began to lose a lot of my grip on who I was and who I hoped to become.
How much did you weigh at the height of your...
At the height? I weighed about 87 pounds at the time I was hospitalized. That was after a period of 5 months of increasing weight loss.
And what was hospitalization like?
It was, to me, a vision of the ancient bedlam. I was, by that time, because I was extremely upset. I was experiencing and not understanding it, a lot of the symptoms of starvation that include just a loss of sense of reality, a great paranoia of people, an absolute craving for food that was insatiable, absolutely insatiable. If I would eat, I would not sit down and eat. I would attack like a wolf and devour everything in sight, whether it was cold, leftover in a garbage can, no matter what it was. I was literally starving to death, and I couldn't put my finger on the fact that I was starving. I knew that after eating, I certainly didn't feel better. I felt very uncomfortable. And I was hysterical. I would throw my food across the room at the table when they'd sit and try to get me to eat. And I felt every feeling that as a preschool teacher, I now see the children at the tables do when they are ill-tempered or in a bad mood, refusing to eat, shunning food. I felt like the little girl that everyone was begging. Now sit up and eat your beets. And in a very evil little child, malice was in me too, as people would be sitting there coaxing me to eat. At one point I said to a mental health worker who was locked in a room with me trying to get me to eat, "Why should I sacrifice my stomach to feed your eyes?" And that's the way I felt about what was happening. I felt that eating would be a thing of death to me. I felt that my body couldn't handle or process the food anymore, that it was broken.
What made you change your mind about food?
The doctor presented me with a choice. He said that I would either, that I was under his care at this point, that the primary purpose of my existence at that point was to eat more, something that really wasn't helping me distinguish who I was very much either, since my primary purpose at that point was to figure out what I was going to do with my life. However, being in a state of starvation is not very conducive to creative mental thought. Therefore, he gave me the option that I would either eat more or I would have a nasogastric tube put down my nose and throat in order to give me hyperalimentation. So I didn't want to do that. I thought that if I was going to die, it would at least be at my own hands and not at the doctor's hands, and I would rather eat myself to death, as I felt that I could do, rather than allow him to do that to me. And some mental health workers also began to talk to me. They placed me on a locked ward with the violent patients. I was told I couldn't leave until I had gained 10 pounds. And I stayed there for days and days and refused to eat. It wasn't very difficult to refuse to eat when it was so painful. It was harder to eat, but they told me, "Your life is in your hands. You can either get yourself off this ward or you will stay here for months and months and months, and you can stay here to 6 months to a year, or you can get off of here within a month." And I didn't want to stay any longer. It was too boring, and I had no place there. So even though I was afraid to, I began to eat very heavily, and this was what I had been afraid of from the start, the fact that I was no longer in control of my consumption of food. I was not experiencing any internal regulation that was helping me to decide how to discriminate. Stop, you're full, you need to do something else. I was simply gorging, gorging, gorging. I couldn't stop eating no matter what. So I began to eat like this uncontrollably. I'd eat 2 and 3 trays at a time, as tiny, as thin as I was. And I would always immediately run straight to my bed and lie down and wait to die, and I never did die. I just felt better and better, and I began to gain weight. And after I had gained 10 pounds, I was up to 98 pounds. I was put on the open ward. I was no longer on the locked ward. And I began to start to have more than normal feeling towards food. I felt like my appetite was clicking back in, and at a certain weight, at about 110 pounds, it was working. I began to experience hunger again, and I was full. I would be satiated. And to me, I felt like I had been blessed. It was a gift from God, for I was back with the human race. I could sit and talk to people when I was eating instead of eating after everyone had left the room and then only out of the garbage can. A behavior I knew I was doing and had an internal logic, but I also am aware that it's unusual in a society like this. But after a while, after I left the hospital, I got a job as a waitress and back in food land.
How do you feel about food now?
Now, I hate it. I regard it as a necessary evil. I have no pleasure in it. It's some weird sensory experience that must be done in order to live. I'm aware that once I've swallowed the food and it's inside of me, there's nothing I can do about it. But I'm still having the problem of there's nothing in me that tells me it's time to eat or time to not eat. And I don't tend to, when I do eat, I tend to eat myself sick rather than, and I never know till I'm through it that I've done it, and I just go like, uh-oh, time bomb went off again. That didn't feel very good. I really dread it. It's 4 days before Thanksgiving. I dread that day with all my heart because I will either eat and get sick, which is really not at this point too uncommon for most of the population on that day, but I will perhaps not and feel very left out and lonely as a result, because it is clear to me that there's something wrong with me that most people are not really experiencing, and that makes me feel lonely and sad sometimes.
How do you think anorexia can be prevented?
I don't know if it can, because I'm not sure that it's completely a psychological disease. To me, it's the fact that its appearance is so consistent in such a definite portion of the population leads me to believe that it's like as if a certain group of people had developed a lemming-like instinct, self-starvation. It's supposed to be the dieter's disease, that it's a result of cultural influences to look thin. And from my perspective, I find that difficult to understand. I've never been overweight, never wanted to lose weight, and the fact that I was losing weight seemed to me an unhealthy thing, whereas adamant anorexics usually think that it's a virtue to look like a concentration camp inmate. I've been in a therapy group, and it helps to give you a perspective on why food can become a convenient focus for your thought rather than more difficult aspects of life, being close to people, being creative in your relationships with people, being loving, that it's easier to think about food and become obsessed with your illness than it is to be a healthy human being. But at the same time, I'm not sure that it can be prevented, because I can't think back to a way to have prevented it in myself. I simply wish that there was something I could do to help myself at this point.
How did you feel about food as a child?
Well, I guess I'd be like any other kid. I liked candy and cookies and potato chips and that sort of thing. My parents are from England, and they were brought up in the same lifestyle that, you know, you eat a lot of sugar, you eat a lot of candies and chocolates and stuff. So from there, that's how I got to like it. I still like it a lot, but I try to avoid it if I can, which is hard.
When did you start having problems with food?
I guess when I was about 13, 14 years old. At that time, I was pretty much the same height I am now. I was 5 foot, and I weighed 93, but I always thought that I was really fat. I think it's because I hung around girls that were fat, and they got me into thinking that, you know, I got into their problems. And actually, I wasn't fat back then. I can realize it now. But that's when I started really becoming aware of my body and what my weight was. And when I hit 100, I really started getting worried. That's about it.
And what did you start doing? What kind of food program did you put yourself on?
Well, I started cutting back. I didn't eat any bread. I didn't drink milk. I didn't have any butter, anything like that. I just mainly stuck to fruits and vegetables and meat. That was, and eggs. That was about it. I tried to stay away from everything, which was making it a lot worse, because then I became like a sneak eater. You know, I'd go down in the nighttime or something and eat a candy bar or something like that. The worst time I had was when I fasted. I just decided that instead of cutting out just a few things, I cut out everything completely. And then I did for 10 days. And I lost a lot of weight. I went from 112 to 93. And I even one night fixed all my favorite foods for a meal and sat down and watched my whole family eat it and just sat there and drank a diet 7-Up. They thought I was kind of crazy at the time, but I did it mainly out of my own willpower to see if I could go away without eating. I did for a while.
Did you have a sense of your own willpower and being in control of food?
Did I have a sense? Yes, I did. And it was a nice feeling. I became aware of the TV ads and magazine ads. All the ads all seemed to relate back to food, and I became very aware of it. And I was feeling proud of myself that I could go this long without food. And I went back to the doctor after 10 days. He told me it was time to start eating again because I was on the verge of starvation. My body started to dehydrate. I felt so good about it, though. I didn't want to stop. I just wanted to keep on going because I liked the feeling of knowing I wasn't putting on any weight. I had a lot of energy, but, you know, the energy had to quit sometime after all the muscle fat, all the extra carbohydrates had been used up. But I think that's when it started to become a problem, because I tried again about 2 months later. I tried to fast again, and I couldn't. I went out playing racquetball one day and fainted. And that was a little embarrassing. And so I started to eat again.
Did you have any friends who had eating problems, and what were their problems?
Well, at my age, when I was 15, 16, everybody was very body conscious, I guess, at that age. But it seemed to me that most of the people I hung around with were a little bit overweight. And they were conscious of their bodies. There was nothing wrong with mine, but I started to think there was. So I started to diet with them, even though I didn't need to. So, yes, they were all very aware. I don't really know what their habits were, how they started to lose weight. I think a few did fast. I knew a lot of girls that did fast, and some would go for, like, up to 30 days. I even read a book about it, and found out that people can go as long as a year if it's controlled in a hospital and such. But no, they had no certain way.
How do you feel about food now?
Well, I'm really aware of it, what I eat. I feel very guilty when I eat something like spaghetti, or very, very conscious of all the foods. I think I always will be. I'm just one of those kind of people.
How do you think people with food obsessions can help themselves, or how that can be prevented?
Well, I think it's mainly up to them, the way they eat, their patterns. The only thing they could really do is read about it. Like, read a book about fasting, or, you know, read some kind of a medical book that tells you about certain cases, what has happened to those people after they did fast, they did something along those lines, how sick they really got. It's just, the whole thing for dieting is just to don't look at it as dieting. Just look at it as cutting back. Because the moment you say you're going to diet, that's when you start to have cravings for those things, because you're missing out. If you could just cut back on everything, that would be the only way to prevent it.
Vicki, how did you feel about food as a child?
I think when I was a child, you mean when I was really young, I loved it. I remember My parents would always feed me, and I was the most well-fed child. I wasn't a fat child, but I had all kinds of variety, and I was the one that liked squash and sauerkraut and everything that all the kids said yuck at school about. I loved my grandmother's cooking. She's from the country, and she'd always make me fresh cherry pies, and I loved food. I mean, I didn't love it as in I was an obese person, but I really enjoyed eating. It was a nice thing for me, very satisfying.
And then at what age did you get anorexia?
I started on the road to anorexia when I was, I guess, 13 years old. That was the seventh grade, and that's when I got interested in ballet, so much so that I decided to go to a summer camp for dancing. And my dancing teacher said, well, you're going to have to lose weight. And at this point, I weighed about 105. And that first summer, I got down to about 99, which is really a pretty good weight for somebody who's 5'2". It's fine. You know, it's slim enough. And then I got more anorexia the next year when I started thinking, well, if I'm this skinny, then I can be a little bit more skinny. And, of course, their daughters, they had three daughters that they were trying to make into dancers, were naturally slim, and naturally they had the smaller bones and they were taller people. And they had, like, the body of a fourth grader up until they were 16, you know, so I was competing with this, and me, I had flourished, and I was like the developed seventh grader, and so this is what I was fighting against. I was fighting against my own body type. So in the eighth grade that summer, I decided that I was going to lose some weight, and I don't know if I really made the decision that I was going to lose some weight, but I decided that I was going to latch on to some kind of control. I can't describe what it is, but I was going to eat less, and I was going to become a superhuman or something by being in total order. I would be able to eat. In fact, what I did eat was, to start losing weight, was one cucumber, a teaspoon of dressing, one orange pop, and a glass of water a day. And that's what I ate. And I sat out in the sun in these plastic sweatpants, you know, and just sat there and baked for an hour. And then I'd get cellophane and wrap my legs. This was in the summer. And I'd get the heating pad and the heating blanket on, and I'd lie there at night, and I'd wake up, and I'd just be an absolute sweaty mess the next morning. But I was on my way to losing weight, you know. I guess I got down to about 85 pounds before I went to camp in the eighth grade. My parents said that is enough, you know, and I'd started eating kind of funny, and my parents were a little concerned about leaving me at this dance camp. And then at dance camp, they were really concerned about me because I'd have a half a bite of shrimp, and then I'd OD my plate with mustard and ketchup and pickles and onions, and I'd feast on mustard and pickles, and I must have smelled so bad, you know. But I just thrived on condiments, you know, I just thrived on them, and I don't know if there was a sugar in the ketchup or what it was, but I wouldn't eat anything else because I didn't like my stomach full. But then I came home, and I guess I weighed around, when I got home, I weighed about 70. And then when I was home, fearing that I wouldn't be getting the dancing that I had, I still wouldn't eat. And my parents were just paranoid and a half with me not eating. But I got down to 64 finally, and they told me, okay, either you're going to quit dancing or you're going to start eating some things. And they kept really close watching me, but I was still very, very paranoid. And the thing that I would do, because I literally couldn't eat at that point, you know, I'd got myself so skinny, that I decided to start chewing gum, and I got great satisfaction out of chewing gum. So I would literally go up in the afternoons and say, Mom, I'm going up to the store, and the store was maybe a mile from me, and I'd walk every day and buy the boxes of gum. I'm not talking about packages, I'm talking about boxes, once a day, and I ended up chewing 100 packs of gum a day. Well, my mouth is an absolute wreck because of it. But that's how I would get, just chew, chew, chew. And I remember when I was in the ninth grade, I guess all the kids went to this one movie, this midnight movie, and I guess I'd had 10 packs of gum with me at that movie. But they ran out, and I was desperate, and I was willing to pay $5 for a pack of gum. I was so desperate, you know. It was a very Very strange thing. I mean, it's almost strange that I'm sitting here getting so excited about it. That's the only thing that worries me about anorexia. It was almost like I did it, and I'm still kind of excited that I did it, you know? And I think that's the one thing that disturbs me the most about anorexia.
Were you hospitalized for anorexia?
No, but I had all kinds of tests done on me when I got back. I had quit my period. So I walk in there at 64 pounds, and the doctor says, "Are you pregnant?" And I said, "Do I look pregnant?" You know? So I wasn't hospitalized, but they were really thinking that pretty soon I might have to be, because I was really lucky. I don't know if dancing kept me going or what. You know, I never developed a pot belly like they would, you know, with extreme deficiencies in protein. But, you know, because I guess I danced and I kept my stomach flat. But I did have a lot of medical problems. They tried to give me... When I first initially got home, they tested me for all kinds of diseases, and I had to get a smallpox vaccination over, because I had just, I guess, run my body out of all the natural things and antibodies that it had in it. So I had to get that, and I also had to have, there's this one little spot right here that connects your lip to your gum, and I had to have it cut because it was pulling my gum from my teeth because I was so thin. And so they had to do an operation to disconnect that so that my teeth wouldn't fall out, because my teeth were getting in real bad shape. Other things, I think maybe they put me on some potassium to see if I could put some water. I know they did some urinalysis on me, and like I'd come back and they'd have like this much for a 24-hour period, and they said, "Look, we've got to have a 24-hour period, you know, thing here." And I said, that's it, you know. And so that is all that I did, except for the extensive medical problems that I've had since, you know, like besides just psychologically being wrapped up in it, and I don't know if you get a little paranoid because you're so much littler than everybody else in the world, the different ways that they look at you. But besides psychologically, just the damage that I've done to my body, I mean, I know I've been trying to have kids and I haven't been able to. I know my tubes were closed, and I don't know if that was something that I had before or if it was something that was caused by anorexia. And I know that after I had anorexia, on my way to recovery, I don't know if my body had a reversal in metabolism or what it was, but it was like everything I would eat, I couldn't get rid of. I'd eat a salad and I'd gain weight. And then, after I got so high, like say I got up to 118, then my own self took over and said, "Well, as long as I'm here, I might as well eat." And so I'd eat and I'd eat and I'd eat and I'd eat, and I'd get up to 100. My maximum weight that I gained was, I got back up on the rebound to 135 pounds. And for 5'2", that's a chunk. I don't know, It's pretty interesting to see what this disease has done to me, both psychologically, physically. But back to your original question about hospitalization, I never was. I don't know if I should have been. I think in a way I was one of the lucky few that didn't die. That was a dancer. I'd heard of so many dancers that died because they'd vomit, induced vomiting. I wouldn't vomit, but I'd chew and spit food in the toilet. But I wasn't hospitalized, but somehow or another, I was one of the few individuals that worked through it.
What made you start eating?
Well, I think the ultimate threat from my parents was, either you quit dancing or we'll take you out of ballet if you don't start eating. Besides the fact that I wonder if psychologically I was ready to start eating, because I had deprived myself for so long. And there were so many things that I enjoyed tasting, but I didn't like the calories. I didn't like what they did to me. And I think that's why I chewed and spit so much. I'd chew and, a donut, you know. But then I'd get rid of it and I wouldn't have to take the necessary burden of what I'd eaten, because I guess I really liked all kinds of things, spaghetti and, you know, donuts and candy and, you know, everything, variety. But I didn't like what it would do to me once I'd consumed it. And I wasn't your natural burn-it-up type. No, repeat the question again, Tim. what started me eating?
Yeah.
Mainly my parents, and I don't know if my parents started me eating, but I think after I'd gotten down so thin, I don't know if I scared myself a little bit or if it was my natural live motive or what, but I know I was obsessed with, I started eating more, but then I started eating more of the condiments and the mustard and the onions and more and more and more. And my mom says, you're just trying to keep boys away from you. This, you don't realize this psychologically, but you are. And so I would eat so many onions and I'd reek and pickles. And I sounded like a pregnant person, but I wasn't. And then I was obsessed with eating gravy. I loved gravy, but I was thin, but that's all I would eat is gravy. I would literally get bowls of gravy and eat it. Now, bread, no, I couldn't eat the bread because it filled me up too much. But anything that was liquid, that had any kind of food calories in it, I'd start eating. And I think maybe because I was so rejected from the society, not that I cared, because I really loved it when I was dancing and the guy lifted me and went, whoa, you know, and I fell over his shoulder, you know. Or I was in an opera, and I kept hearing these woos and oohs in the back of me. God, look how skinny that girl is, you know, in the back. And I don't know if I got off on that, or if underneath, in a sense, it was almost now that I was a freak. And maybe I didn't want to be the role of a freak. I wanted to be thin and be different than everybody else, my uniqueness, I guess, maybe. But I didn't want to be a freak, so maybe I started eating a little bit. And I think I got a pretty good scare when they did the gum surgery. And, you know, some things weren't working out with me. I was very sick. I got sick a lot, and I was susceptible to everything that came around, and I got real sick. And, you know, everybody'd be just like this when I got sick, you know, because I could have been on the other side pretty quick.
Did you like what you looked like at 65 pounds?
No, I kept staring in the mirror saying I was fat. I'm sure, in fact, I should have brought some pictures. I would stare at myself and I'd say, I'm fat. And I don't know what compelled me to say that as I look at the pictures now and go, God, you know, I was just a literal bone. I looked like I was from Biafra without the stomach. I mean, you could see my heart beating. You could poke your finger in the back and see it in the front. I could literally pull my veins out of my body. I was just so skinny. It was just gross. And yet, I loved the weightlessness of it all. And I don't know if it was in dancing, because, you know, your leg would just go up and it was effortless, or, you know, I don't know. When I looked at myself, it'd really be hard to say if I thought probably at the time that it was great underneath it all, and yet I'd still go, oh, I'm so fat. Who knows, maybe searching for compliments. I don't know. I can't really say.
How do you feel about food now?
I enjoy food, but I don't like what it does to me still. It's really sad. Now it's almost like if I don't dance and if I don't work, and if I don't do something to deserve the food, in a sense, I don't deserve to eat. If I'm sitting around the house, or if I've just been around the house and I've been crocheting or cleaning up the house, not doing any physical exertion, not, quote-unquote, burning up the calories, then I don't really deserve to eat. I mean, I fool myself all the time and say, I'm going to be on a 1,000-calorie diet, or I'm going to be on this diet, and I'm going to follow it perfectly. But I don't, and every morning still, I won't eat much, and then for lunch, I won't eat much because I'm dancing, and then I'll have a nice dinner. But I'm always conscious of what's going in, what's going out. I'm on the scale the next morning. If I've put on a pound, then I'm on a diet the next day. You know, just trying to maintain this kind of balance. Part of it is the stress that's put on me and being thin, being a dancer, you know, because I have to wear pink tights and leotards every day. And so it's a pain in the rear to have an extra pound on you when you're dancing. And it's a pain in the rear when you're standing there, and I'm 25, and my body size is compared to 18-year-olds who I'm dancing with, who still haven't really Oh, I don't know if they've ultimately developed their total womanness or their bone structure, what some of them are still really kind of shy in their bodies. And so I'm constantly being thrown with these 12-year-olds, and, you know, so in a sense I'm still really conscious of that. And so when I eat, I know I'm still very conscious of what I eat. And yet, I'll have my binges. Okay, what I would do is I would eat, now, what I'll do is like I'll starve and eat 600 calories a day during the week, and then on Friday night and Saturday, I can eat whatever I feel like I want to eat. I can eat a hamburger, or I can eat fries. And then, sometimes on Sunday, I'll fast. So that Monday morning, when I have to go put those pink tights on again, I don't have to feel like I've got hamburgers and french fries written all over my stomach. I don't do that as obsessively as it sounds, because a lot of times I'll eat more or less. I'm really now starting to eat things that are good for me for the first time in my life. I'm eating cheese and I'm eating salad. Of course, that's always a part of an anorexic's life, a salad, but I'm eating cheese and I'm eating meat and vegetables more regularly. And I'm trying somehow to get a balance. I really am working on trying, because I realize that, daggum, you know, in 25 years, I don't want my teeth to fall out. I mean, I'm really becoming consciously aware of how far I can push my body. And an anorexic, when you're young, you think you are invincible, that there's nothing that goes wrong. But when you get older and things start going wrong because of the 10 years previous, you're going, whoa. You know, you don't realize that your teeth are going to fall out and your bones are going to rot and you're going to get some kind of a disease. When you're a kid, I can do anything, you know, and nothing's going to matter. You don't think of future when you're a kid, but when you're a little older, you start thinking in sequences of time. But I'm learning. I still have my weaknesses. Of course, I guess everybody has their weaknesses in dieting. It's just that I control mine differently than the obese person who chooses to just eat, 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 eat. I choose to eat what I want, and also at the same time maintain some kind of a body style. And if that means that I have to binge on one day to express my ego, I mean my id, and then the second time I express my super ego by restraining, you know, and being this size or this ideal person, maybe that's what I do. That's how I handle it.
How do you think anorexia can be prevented?
Oh, it's really hard. I would say, you know, I'm really not sure about the basis of anorexia. Some people say that it hit a certain group of people, a certain age group, certain girls that had certain kind of problems or ambitions. I know that I have personally talked to some girls that were having anorexia, and I would say, you know, I'd say, don't. You know, do you realize what's going to happen? And they just got off on it all the more. So sometimes by using the straightforward, here you go, it's not, it doesn't work. I had a girl that did that and asked me, and I said, God, you're going to get sick. You know, you really are. This is the fact. I went through it. But she liked the excitement of that so much, that fantasy of being thin, that she got anorexia. And, well, she didn't really have a bad case of it, but the doctor put weight on her immediately. I think a person, parents can be very aware of children that have special needs. In my instance, my sister was very homely, not a very pretty child, you know, very uncoordinated. Me, I was coordinated, I was outgoing, I was, you know, I could do anything. And I would literally bust my gusset to show my parents to get the approval that I needed. And yet, they wouldn't necessarily give me the approval, oh, Vicky's okay. And they give all my the approval to Linda, because for Pete's sake, they were trying to get her to blossom and to get coordinated and help Linda, help Linda, help Linda. Meanwhile, I was screaming for the attention. Maybe I could do all these things, but I needed the attention. Today, my sister is a very secure person. She's still uncoordinated. She's a beautiful person. I mean, she's beautiful facially and is very intelligent and very secure. I would say I'm more insecure, more confused, more unsure, more and at rest most of the time. And I would say that that's a contributing factor. Maybe anorexia to me was like the ultimate expression, look at me, you know, what about me, you know, indirectly. I don't think I did that directly to say, parents, look at me. But maybe somehow that had something to do with it. I would say parents must be aware of their children. Not favoritism necessarily, but look at the insights. Maybe those people that are talented, and maybe they're the ones that need the compliments more than the person that is kind of homely but more secure a lot of times. Anorexia is a funny thing. You just don't know where it's going to hit. So it's really hard to say how I would prevent it. My parents couldn't have prevented me of getting it, even if they'd shake their finger at me. My parents knew I was a very independent, belligerent, I'm going to do what I'm going to do. And I think probably even if they had put me in the hospital or taken me out of dancing, I would have been thin, because that was the decision I had made. And I was a pretty stubborn, bullheaded kid. So I don't think in my case there was really any preventative medicine that my parents could have done, except by giving me the feelings I needed as a child, more attention. That's all I can think of is preventative medicine for me. It's really hard. You just don't know where anorexia is going to strike. Anorexia strike me. My parents were flabbergasted. You know, I was the know everything, do everything, be happy. I was little miss vibrant, middle miss everything. And why, of all things, did it hurt me? Was I punishing myself because of the person I was? My father was an attorney at law. I had cultural advantages. Was I punishing myself to be like everybody else so that they wouldn't say, well, she's got money, so that's why she makes A's, that's why she's doing so well in life, to put myself back on their level somehow? No, look, I work as hard as anybody. Was that the reason why I did it? I don't know. Was it the cultural point that I was in life and there was no way out and I was damned because my father was a lawyer and I had the opportunity to be good in school and dance and do some things other people didn't do, but I worked like a horse doing them, and then the other people didn't work at all. All they did was criticize me because I had the cultural advantage and because I worked. I was a study woman. Well, from all those fears, when I was 16, I worked myself into ulcers, you know, from the pressure and everything else. But I it's really hard to say what preventative medicine is. You just have to, maybe it is those people that are diligent, concerned, wanting to be something, wanting to do something with their life, wanting to be more. Maybe those are the people that have the biggest problem with anorexia. Maybe it's not the people that are kind of, hey, you know, here I am, and I'm not very talented, but I'm okay. Maybe those are the people you don't need to worry about so much. Maybe those other people that are so ambitious that are trying to change the world by starting with themselves. You know, maybe those are the people that we need to look at. That's all.
Thank you, Vicki.
How did you feel about food as a child?
Well, I loved it. I basically ate what normal kids eat, cookies and cereals, sugared, you know. But I really, I had no fetishes against it. I enjoyed it. I ate normally, healthy.
When did you get anorexia nervosa?
At about the age of 22. So almost 2 years ago.
And why do you think you got it?
Well, I'm not really sure. At the time when I felt it coming on, I had just gotten married and moved to Hawaii on the matter of about 2 weeks. And when we got to Hawaii, I was suddenly obsessed with exercising intensely and eating a really minimal amount and just went overboard and went crazy about it and just exercised every waking moment and existed on hard-boiled eggs and things like that, and vegetables, nothing substantial.
How long did you have anorexia, and how bad did it get for you? How much weight did you lose?
Well, I went from about 110 to a little under 80, and I'd say I had it full-fledged for about almost a year. And even now, I eat normal, but in the back of my mind, I think I'm more aware of food in a whole different way than I was before I ever had it. I think about it differently. I'm always aware of what I'm eating and how much, even though I don't care anymore. In my subconscious, I must. And I was bad enough to where I came back from Hawaii just for a visit, and my parents sent me to a doctor. And he basically kind of set me straight, but even when I went back to Hawaii, I still was a little kooky and, you know, ate funny. I kind of got myself out of it once we moved. I think the reason why I did get it was almost rebellious for getting married and moving away and kind of just all of a sudden feeling alone. It was like something I could do for myself. So I think that's what it was. And once we moved back here, I felt secure again. That's kind of what I think it was, the cause of it.
What did you eat when you had anorexia?
Hard-boiled eggs. Quesadillas, but not fried in butter. some fruits, not a lot, and a lot of water. That was probably about it. A few vegetables, you know, celery and very non-fattening vegetables.
And how did the doctor help you when you had it?
Well, he just made me realize that I've always been thin, which I was. The most I ever weighed was 110, and all my life I wanted to gain weight. I gave anything to be 115 when I was 18. He just made me realize that I didn't have a weight problem and that I never would and that it was okay to eat, you know, to eat as much as I wanted simply because I wasn't the kind of person that would have to worry about it, and that I did look fine, but not at the weight I was then, but that at the weight I used to be, because he was my regular doctor. I had been going to him for years. So he wasn't a psychiatrist or psychologist. He was a normal family doctor. And he just made me realize there was no reason to be doing what I was doing. And I was aware of anorexia since my sister did go through it when she was young. And I was younger, and I remember she did have to go see a psychologist. And I remember that kind of scared me, the thought of it.
How do you feel about food now?
Well, I eat everything. Like I say, I think I'm just more aware of what I'm eating and how much. I feel fine about it. I don't feel paranoid about it, and I don't really worry about my weight anymore. Like, I might joke around and say, oh, I better watch my weight a little, but I don't do anything about it. I just say that. I feel really fine about it. I really don't think I'd go through something like that again. I think I'm much more stable now, and I really don't have a reason to. But I enjoy eating now and everything.
How do you think anorexia can be prevented?
I don't really think it could be, because I don't think it could have been prevented for me. I think maybe once it got started, it could be caught and contained. But there's really no way that certain people are subject to it and others aren't, because I never thought I was. And suddenly at 22, I was anorexic. So I really don't think there's a way to prevent it, just a way to hopefully contain it once it's happened. It'd be nice if there was, but I just don't think, in my opinion, there's anyone you can say they're going to be prone to get anorexic, so we'll have to watch them. I suppose but I didn't feel I was a typical anorexic candidate, because I never was pressured by my parents or by school or anything like that. Maybe, like I say, though, the pressures of marriage suddenly and moving were. But who would have thought that, you know, I really couldn't have prevented that unless I didn't want to get married and I wanted to. So I don't know, it's kind of a tricky question, I guess. As parents, because it does seem to happen younger when girls and boys are still with their parents, just to, not really put a lot of emotional pressures on them and strains. But I really wouldn't know. How did you feel about food as a child?
Well, I know that as a infant, as a newborn, I was allergic to my formula. I wasn't breastfed, I was given a bottle. I was allergic to that and was switched to, I think, something other than evaporated milk. I couldn't drink evaporated, maybe goat's milk or something. So I must have had some sort of food thing very early in my life. And then at 7, I was hospitalized because I was vomiting every day because of being afraid to go to school or not wanting to go to school because people were stepping on my coat in school, so every day I would vomit. And my parents put me in the hospital because I was vomiting, but I was vomiting for a very simple reason. And once I verbalized the reason, I stopped vomiting. So I always had food games that I was playing as a child, hiding food around my plate and spitting it out and running to the bathroom and hiding it in my mouth. And I remember more the games with food than liking food.
When did you get anorexia and why?
I was a nun in a convent, and before I went in the convent, they said, you'll have to gain a lot of weight in order to get into this convent. So I drank many, many milkshakes and gained a lot of weight, and I was pretty pudgy when I entered the convent. And then once I was in the convent, gained a lot more weight and enjoyed food quite tremendously while I was there. And then after being there for 2 years, I stopped eating the right proportions of food that I was supposed to eat every day. And I think it started as a diet between two of us. Both of us were going to go on diets, and it started that way. And I started liking the diet aspect, and I liked controlling my food intake, and I liked watching what I was eating and not eating and hiding it. And then we had to confess every day that we weren't eating. And I had to go in and confess I wasn't eating, but I was still not eating. And I started getting very, very thin, and I started getting very, very active, filled with energy. And they kept putting me on outside duty, and I would run with lawnmowers over the hills. And because I was so energetic, because everything was being eaten up, we had teeny little mirrors. We only had little teeny mirrors to look at ourselves in these lockers. And I remember one time opening my locker and standing on a chair so I could see more of myself than just my face. And I remember seeing a lot of bones, and I realized I was getting very thin. And I was down to 82 pounds, and went in finally to the novice mistress and said that I think that something's going on with my food and me. And she said, yes, we've been worried about you. And then I said, well, will I be voted out of this convent if when the vote time comes around, will you vote me out? And they said, well, most likely, because of your attitude and this food thing, you'll probably be voted out. And I said, well, then I quit. And I called my uncle and then my parents, and a few days later they came and picked me up. And my mother brought five or six different sized dresses, and I remember going down the stairs in this white dress and these teeny arms and little mini mouse feet and no hair and a white scarf over my head. And my parents took me out to dinner, and I ate a whole lobster.
How do you feel about food now?
Well, it took me many years to switch back from all of that activity. And for years I couldn't go in restaurants because I'd have to eat in front of people. And my most uncomfortable times were at dinner tables or when I had to sit down and eat in front of people. Or I was a sort of a secret eater. I was really good if I could run in a corner and eat in a corner, or eat looking out of a window, or eat standing. It was much more comfortable for me for many years. And I would separate myself off from people around mealtimes so that I could take care of that. And so only recently have I begun to feel more comfortable with food, but friends would have to, I'd sometimes get under the table in a restaurant, it would be so uncomfortable. And I mean, sort of half joking, but, or just have to sit really close to someone because I'd be just frightened, sort of almost frightened of the food coming, and they put it down, and then you have to eat it, and you have to say something, and you have to, you'd be in this social situation. And but it's getting much better, and I'm getting much more comfortable and not fixating as heavily on food.
Did you have eating binges and then vomiting?
No, I just really curtailed how much I ate, and then I would exercise a lot. I would work everything off in as much as I could. And when I was small, I vomited when I was 7, but not when I was 22 and had anorexia. Or when I had a food problem. I'm not even sure it was anorexia. It was, it stopped. I stopped being 82 pounds once I left the convent. So it was a short term, maybe 6, 7, 10 months, a year or something.
Did you feel you didn't deserve to eat?
Probably that, but I felt more that I liked more the challenge of making myself do something and controlling my body and controlling my food intake and being high. I was so energetic and so alert and alive, and I had so much energy, and I was running around, and it seemed like somebody was pushing me from the back. I had so much, you know, jive. It was just a great energetic feeling, and I liked that feeling a lot. The other, when I was weightier and when I was not 82 pounds, I just felt too lethargic. So I think I was more addicted not to, I was very addicted to the feeling of energy, of the kind of energy that was happening with not eating.
What was your diet like?
Well, it was the food that was served to us as nuns, you know, meat, potatoes, vegetables, all cooked. And when we ate in silence every day for 3 meals a day. And while we were eating, they read stories of saints and martyrs. So, in a sense, it wasn't the most comfortable eating situation. I mean, we were all sitting across from each other, you know, eight at a table with a novice mistress at one end, and 50 people, no more than that, 100 or so people in a room, and then someone sitting at a lectern reading about saints, martyrs, missionaries. It wasn't your comfortable, you know, eating situation. And I've forgotten the question, but that's
what your diet was like.
Oh, my diet. So it was all institutional food. And in a sense, in the beginning, all I looked forward to were meals, because the nuns' existence is very, very everyday repetition of patterns. There's not too much change. You get up at 5:30, you meditate, eat breakfast, work, pray, a lot of ritual, and the ritual was wonderful. There was much that was tremendous and wonderful about being there. But sometimes food, wanting food became obsessive, and then turning the other direction, not wanting food became as obsessive. But I didn't have any strange dietary things happening except just denial. I didn't eat just cucumbers, or I didn't eat diet soda because those weren't available. I ate the nun's food, but I didn't eat it. I would take small portions and I would kind of spread it around my plate and not eat.
How do you think anorexia or food obsession could be prevented?
Talking. I mean, I think that my basic problem was being nonverbal. And I had no way to, I didn't know what I was feeling, for one thing, and then I had no way to verbalize what I was feeling, so that my body started to talk for me. Because no words were coming out of my mouth, my body said, okay, some messages are coming through. And the message was, something's going on, and it's pretty strange. And how do you know? So my body literally forced me to think about and to verbalize what was going on in my life. So I think talking about things is an incredible gift. And if that can be done, if people have access to people who they can talk with, then that's one prevention. I guess that's all I can think about in terms of prevention.